The Dome of the Rock is one of the most iconic buildings in the world, showing up in travel posters everywhere as an integral part of the Jerusalem skyline. It's one of the most sacred sites in the world for Muslims today, believed to be the site of the Prophet Muhammad's night journey and ascension, a story briefly told in the Quran and expanded in later literature, in which Muhammad miraculously travels from Mecca to Jerusalem overnight before ascending into heaven to meet the prophets and God. The building is also a source of controversy as it stands on the same spot as the first and second Jewish temples, the holiest site for Jews, and a site of vital importance to their religious history. Control of the Temple Mount itself, or as it's called by Muslims, the Haram al-Sharif, the noble sanctuary, remains in a delicate political balance. The Israeli government controls access, but the Jerusalem Waqf, an Islamic administrative body largely funded by the Jordanian government, manages all of the affairs in the sanctuary itself. For a building that looms so large in history and modern politics, what even is the Dome of the Rock? What was it used for, and what's its status today? First of all, it's important to realize that the Dome of the Rock is not a mosque, but better described as a shrine. However, we're not exactly sure about its original meaning and intended ritual function. It was built in the late 7th century under the Umayyads, an early Islamic dynasty that wrested control of Jerusalem away from the Byzantine Empire. By that time, it seems that the Temple Mount had been abandoned. Centuries before, in 70 CE, the Roman general Titus had destroyed the second Jewish temple, and the Romans had built a temple to Jupiter in its place. But by the time the Umayyads got there, many scholars think that the Christian rulers of Jerusalem were using it as a garbage dump, having long since plundered it for its stone for other building projects. This is largely based on textual evidence, though. It's possible that some sort of Christian structure was on the Temple Mount at the time, and it was not abandoned after all. This is based on pieces of a late antique church found by the Temple Mount Sifting Project, an Israeli archaeological project sifting through 9,000 tons of soil dug out during a controversial renovation by the Waqf in 1999. Regardless, the Umayyads started construction on the Dome of the Rock and completed it sometime in the 690s, according to an inscription inside the building itself. And although its octagonal shape is unique for Islamic architecture, this was not a unique shape for nearby Byzantine churches and shrines at the time. Octagonal churches could be found throughout the region. In fact, the archaeologist Rina Avner argues that the Dome of the Rock architects must have modeled it after the Church of the Kathisma, only 3 miles away on the outskirts of Jerusalem. This octagonal church was active at the same time as the Dome of the Rock, and it also features a stone at its center, where it was believed that the Mother Mary had rested on her way to Bethlehem. You can still see this today. It's sitting on the side of a highway, and you can clearly see its original octagonal shape and the rock at its center. The interior space for both of these buildings was suited for walking around a stone. Scholars like to use the fancy term circumambulating, walking around a specific rock or pillar or some object, which was a common ritual practice in the late antique Mediterranean world. So it's likely that the Dome of the Rock was drawing on these cultural cues, purpose-built as a pilgrimage shrine, possibly to promote Muslim pilgrimage to Jerusalem. As for its symbolic meaning, its association with Muhammad's night journey actually doesn't become established until decades later. The Umayyad caliph who built the Dome of the Rock, Abd al-Malik, might have built it with this in mind, but we're not sure. Now, of course, he knew the significance of the Temple Mount and may have built the Dome of the Rock as a visual symbol of authority over Christianity, as it would have been rivaling similar domes nearby, specifically the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. In fact, the dimensions of these two domes are almost identical, and there's an inscription inside the Dome of the Rock that specifically counteracts Christian theology by proclaiming Jesus was only a prophet and not God incarnate. But al-Malik could have also built it as a visual symbol of Islam's continuation with past Abrahamic traditions. As the site of Solomon's original temple, he may have been symbolically placing himself in this lineage of great kings. But what's the deal with the rock? As the name suggests, the Dome of the Rock is built over a huge chunk of bedrock, sometimes called the Foundation Stone. For Muslims, this rock is believed to be the exact spot that Muhammad ascended into heaven during his night journey. For many Jews, though, it's the site where God started the creation of the world, where Abraham almost sacrificed his son Isaac, and later became the site of the Holy of Holies in the First Temple. Now, most archaeologists agree that this rock formed the foundation of these earlier temples, though the current political situation makes excavations around the site impossible to confirm this scientifically. Regardless, there might not be anything left to find under the Dome of the Rock, since it seems that later Roman and Byzantine construction projects scraped the bedrock clean as they plundered materials for their own buildings. Below the stone is a partially man-made grotto where you can find a mihrab, a decorative niche that indicates the direction toward Mecca to pray. Although mihrabs are usually found in mosques, as I said earlier, the Dome of the Rock is not a mosque. The nearby Al-Aqsa Mosque, also built during the Umayyad period, fulfills the function of congregational prayer for the local Muslim community. On my visit, the Dome of the Rock was fairly empty, and it seemed to be used for private devotion. A few women were reading the Quran nearby, a few other men and women were walking around the stone, and in the grotto beneath, there was one woman reading or praying by herself. But let's move on to the architectural overview. Another misconception about the Dome of the Rock is that we are looking at its original state of preservation. But the building as we see it today has undergone countless renovations over the centuries. Before the 16th century, for example, the exterior was decorated with mosaics rather than the tiles that we see today, which, in and of themselves, are 20th century replicas of Ottoman-era tiles. The Temple Mount Sifting Project, which I mentioned earlier, possibly has discovered thousands of fragments of this original mosaic, some of which are covered in gold. You can see them right here on the screen. The dome itself was originally copper, and the 10th century geographer Mukaddisi said it was gilded. But later during the Middle Ages, it was covered with lead, which remained in place until the 20th century. In fact, old photographs show the lead dome still in place. The golden dome that we see today was not added until 1964 during the renovation sponsored by the King of Jordan. In some respects, the interior more closely mirrors the 7th century look, consisting of two sets of columns which appear to have been taken from nearby Byzantine churches during its construction. Some ancient mosaics with plant and geometric patterns cover the walls, but some of these also come from the 1960s renovations, who replaced the wooden ceilings and wooden superstructure of the dome. And finally, let's move on to the controversies surrounding the site. As you can imagine, since two major religions view this site as sacred, tensions can run high. Even whether you call it the Temple Mount or the Haram al-Sharif can be taken as a political statement. As of 2018, when I published this video, non-Muslims are generally not allowed inside the Dome of the Rock, except under special circumstances, like being affiliated with an archaeological research institute as I was. The plaza itself is open to Jews and non-Muslims in general, but they are not permitted to pray, read religious texts, or wear religious clothing. Many Jewish religious authorities, including the Chief Rabbinate of Israel, discouraged Jews from entering the site in the first place. The Holy of Holies was the most sacred part of the First and Second Temples. Even the high priest was not allowed to enter unless on Yom Kippur, the holiest day of the year for most Jews. According to these rabbis, because the precise location of the Holy of Holies is unknown, there's a risk of accidentally entering it, and therefore, according to them, it's best not to enter the site at all. Other rabbis are confident in their calculations of where the Holy of Holies was, so they permit Jews to enter the Temple Mount as long as they stay out of these no-go zones and follow the rules of not openly praying. For some fringe groups, though, controversies stem from the desire to build a third Jewish temple in its place. Jewish perspectives on this are diverse. Most conservative and Orthodox Jews in particular believe in the restoration of a temple, but they say it can only happen in the Messianic age after certain miraculous signs have been fulfilled. However, a small minority advocate humans rebuilding the third temple in this age, notably the organization called the Temple Institute. Some fundamentalist Christian groups in America also support the rebuilding of the third temple and see it as a catalyst that could spark the apocalypse, or the second coming of Christ. But for the time being, the status quo of the Temple Mount, or Haram al-Sharif, is maintained in its delicate political and religious balance, with the Dome of the Rock standing as one of the most iconic buildings in the world. As always, sources are in the description below. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.